Scripture reading today is from Exodus 8, verses 16 through 19. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Tell Aaron, stretch out your staff and strike the dust of the ground, and throughout the land of Egypt the dust will become gnats." They did this, and when Aaron stretched out his hand with the staff and struck the dust of the ground, gnats came on people and animals. All the dust throughout the land of Egypt became gnats. But when the magicians tried to produce gnats by their secret arts, they could not. Since the gnats were on people and animals everywhere, the magicians said to Pharaoh, "This is the finger of God." But Pharaoh's heart was hard, and he would not listen, just as the Lord had said.
There's a movie that came out in 2008. How many people remember 2008? Yeah, nine years ago, 2008. The movie was called Vantage Point. Vantage Point. It starred Dennis Quaid. I don't know if you saw this movie or not. The plot breaks down like this, very simply. Dennis Quaid's character is part of the Secret Service, whose job it is to protect the president. There is a big meeting in Spain with lots of world leaders and different things happening, and it turns out there's an explosion and the president's life is threatened. Now what's interesting is, you start the movie and you're watching Dennis Quaid's characters. He prepares for this very big day. He doesn't know what's gonna happen, of course. And you're following along and you get to the explosion, boom, there's chaos, there's, everybody's trying to figure out what's going on, and then the movie stops. And it picks up, and it starts back with a different character that you're following, and it leads through the events of their day, same, geographic location, all the stuff that's going on in their life, and then there's this explosion that threatens the United States president's life, and there's chaos, and nobody knows what's going on, and they're trying to figure out it all, and then the movie stops. And then it picks back up, and this time you're following somebody completely different, and you're looking at their side of this whole thing that's breaking down, what happened, how they perceive the events leading up to it, and it goes on for about 10-15 minutes, and then you can guess what probably happens. It stops. I feel it. And then it picks back up, and it gives you another vantage point, a totally different perspective on the whole thing, and it continues on for about 10 to 15 minutes. Now, what's interesting about this, there are about 8 different vantage points throughout the whole movie. It does this start and stop thing, and there's obviously some overlap that makes you go, okay, I see what they're doing here, but it's very, very interesting, and it's stuck with me. That even though you think on the surface level, okay, I understand what's happening here, this movie does something incredibly brilliant, I thought, in that it gives you a more full story, a fuller perspective, a fuller understanding of what is happening on this day. So today we're going to talk a little bit about your vantage point and see where we go. How's everybody doing? Good, good. I'm going to take a drink, if that's okay. Is that all right? Somebody said no. Is that you? As she takes a drink. I see how it is. Okay. So here's my thought, right? We all have perspectives, right? But most of the time, our perspectives are very personalized. Right? We come to a situation, or we come to an event, or we come to a relationship with all these biases and all these presuppositions and all these ideas about how this story plays out. And we all see different things. And usually, we only see one side of the story. So today I want to ask you, how do you see the plagues in Exodus? I mean, many of us are familiar with the plagues, right? There's 10 of them. We know about, the Nile turns to blood, and the frogs, and the gnats, and the flies, and all that stuff that we're going to get into today. My question is, how do you see them? How do you read about them? What do you perceive about this narrative? Maybe another question is, how do you see the Egyptians, the Pharaoh? When you read through the Bible and you hear this story told and taught and preached, how do you understand who the Egyptians are? Do you read about them and look at them and go, oh, those terrible people. Those awful people. Those people deserved what they got. That Pharaoh, he's such an idiot. He should have just known when to give up. He should have just sucked it all in and said, you know what? I was wrong. How do you see the Egyptians? How do you see God in this story? Do you see God as this mighty warrior who hurls down wrath from heaven against people who have rebelled against him? Or do you see something else?
I think he played it like a chess game. He knew that the Egyptians were all powerful, and they didn't think anything could come up against them.
Yeah.
So he had to make strategic moves, and I think that's how he did it.
That's one perspective. So here's what I want to do. I want you to try and approach this text, approach these stories that we're all very familiar with. I want you to approach them with open eyes, open hearts, open ears, and see if perhaps there's more to the story. Can we do that? Okay, three people. Everybody else can leave. All right, we're going to be in Exodus chapter 8. Exodus chapter 8, if you have a Bible. Exodus chapter 8. Now, we've already been through a couple of things, right? Moses and Aaron. Everybody say Moses.
Moses.
And Aaron. These two guys are messengers from God. They've kind of tried to deliver this message to the Egyptians and to Pharaoh that Israel is going to go free. But at first, all they do is ask for a little worship time, a couple days out in the desert. And so Aaron, he goes before, and Moses goes before, and they say, look, this is God speaking, not a God, the God. He's speaking with real power here. He says that you should let the people go so that they can worship him. Pharaoh says, no, that's not going to happen. And they say, okay, well, you're gonna have to believe us here. Watch. And Aaron throws down his staff, and it turns into a what? A snake. Now, Pharaoh had some other sorcerers and magicians and wise priests, masters of the secret arts, however you want to describe them. They had their tricks, their sleights of hand, their ways of making things appear a certain way. And so when Aaron threw his staff down and turned it into a snake, they said, well, that's no big deal. We can do that. So they threw their staffs down. They became the snakes. And Aaron's staff ate theirs. Whoops. And you fast forward a couple days, and Pharaoh has still said no, and Moses stands on the bank of the Nile with Aaron. He says, look, the Nile's going to turn to blood. You got to let people go. Pharaoh says, nope, not going to happen. And lo and behold, the Nile River, 4,200 miles long, 2 miles across, stretching through several countries and regions, becomes blood. Even in their pots and containers that were already set aside. The people couldn't drink anything. The fish were dying. The people actually had to dig along the edge of the Nile, dig deep wells just to get some clean water. Didn't work. Pharaoh said, no, I don't care. Fast forward a little bit, and Moses says, well, okay. There are going to be frogs, lots of frogs, tons of frogs, frogs all over the place, frogs, 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 frogs in the bedroom, frogs in the kitchen, frogs where you don't want them, frogs all over, frogs. And there were frogs all over the place. And there are just some places where you don't want a frog. Anybody ever been going to the bathroom? And you're sitting there trying to take care of business, and all of a sudden you hear, frogs all over the place. place. Pharaoh says, hey, you got to take care of these frogs. Moses says, okay, but you got to let our people go. He says, no problem, I'll let them go. So Moses, he prays to God, God, please take these frogs away. And he tries. God takes the frogs away. Pharaoh changes his mind, hardens his heart. The people are still enslaved. So we'll pick that up. Exodus chapter 8. Starting at verse 16. Then the Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron, stretch out your staff, strike the dust of the ground, and throughout the land of Egypt, the dust will become gnats. They did this, and when Aaron stretched out his hand with the staff and struck the dust of the ground, gnats came upon men and animals. All the dust throughout the land of Egypt became gnats. But when the magicians tried to produce gnats by their secret arts, they could not. And the gnats were on men and animals. The magician said to Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. But Pharaoh's heart was hard, and he would not listen, just as the Lord had said. Now, in our text, in the NIV, it says gnats. In the King James Version, they translated it as lice. Other scholars think maybe perhaps it was mosquitoes. Anyway, these things are pests. Can we agree to that? They're annoying. They're frustrating. They're hard to get rid of. They itch, they bite, they pinch, they're annoying. And they're all over. Moses, Aaron, excuse me, strikes the dust of the ground and it becomes like gnats. The ground starts to wriggle and move, and suddenly these things are all over the place. In places you don't want bugs to be. Ew. Now, that's gross for us, and we understand that, but I want to show you just one more level here. These Egyptians, especially the Pharaoh and the priests and these magicians, they had a thing about cleanliness. In fact, they would shave every hair off their body, and then ceremonially bathe, so that they would be considered to be clean. If you think about it, do me a favor, think about every Egyptian movie you've ever watched, or every picture of an Egyptian, anything Egyptian at all, they're all clean shaven. Now, the sarcophagus might have one of those golden goatee things, but the people inside, before they turned into rotten corpses, they didn't have beards. They didn't have mustaches. They didn't even have eyebrows. Because they thought to have hair on your body was to compare you to the beasts of the field. And so they wanted to be as clean and as pure and as perfect as possible. Can you imagine those people having bugs everywhere? They had to be going nuts. Had to be driving crazy. So this was at a new level for them. This was at a new grossness. And these magicians, up to this point, they've been able to mimic what God has done. You'll remember, Aaron throws down his staff, it turns into a snake. Aha! The magicians, they throw down their staffs, they turn into snakes. Aha! Aaron, he extends his staff out over the Nile, it turns to blood. Aha! The magicians, they take the little bit of clean water that's dug up and go, well, we can do that too. Aha. The frogs, they come up on the land into places where you don't want frogs. And the magicians, they say, well, we got frogs too. Look at this. But you get to the gnats, and for some reason, they can't duplicate it. They can't mimic it. They can't copy what God has done anymore. I don't know whether it's their inabilities or God's decision to say that's enough. You've had your fun. But either way, these magicians and these priests can't continue to keep copying what has been done. And so they go to the Pharaoh, and these guys who consider themselves to be the cream of the crop, who consider themselves to be the top magicians, the best students of the secret arts, they finally have to admit, this is the finger of God. I was curious when I looked it up how many times that phrase, finger of God, appears in the New in the NIV. The answer is four times. twice in Exodus, this figure of God language. The other time in Exodus is when Moses is bringing the Ten Commandments down. You remember that? Say yes.
Okay.
And the Ten Commandments were said to have been written with the finger of God. It's this phrase that carries with it that whoever this God is, he has authority of some kind. Authority over nature, authority over people, authority over community and relationship. He has some sort of higher level of authority that we can't wrap our minds around. That's what the Egyptian magicians are saying. This is the finger of God. It's one of those moments where you have just like this between the eyes moment of conviction and clarity. You ever have one of those? Where God does something or reveals something within you and you can't help but realize, I was wrong. I was doing some research for this and found out that King James, you know, talks about lice instead of gnats. And I thought, well, that's really interesting. And you guys know all about lice. Many of you are parents, and so you know the terror when you get that notification from the school. There's a student who has lice. And all the parents scramble, and we all freak out, and we douse our kids in bleach, shave their heads. We do whatever we gotta do. When I was growing up, there was a girl, her name's Marcia. And Marcia, she came from a rough background, family didn't have a lot, and you know, she didn't smell the greatest. She ended up wearing the same outfits a couple times during the week, you know, the kind of person that I'm talking about. And off and on, throughout her time at our school, she had lice. And it was one of those things. She had it, she'd be sent home. She'd come back a couple days later, they'd check her, she'd still have it. They'd send her home. And it was like this for years and years. And you guys know what happens. Kids start distancing themselves. Parents, oh so subtly, say, be careful around her. And suddenly Marcia, who just is in the situation she is, becomes unclean, becomes an outcast, becomes rejected. As I was researching this, I was curious. Like, for some reason, she came to my mind, and I thought, well, I wonder where she's at now, what she's doing now, what's happening. And so I'm trying to figure this out. I do what any sensible person would do. I try to Facebook stalk her. And I can't find her. There's four profiles with her name. Two of them don't have photos. Thanks to Facebook security measures, of course, you can't access a lot of information unless you're someone's friend. And I was hit with this conviction. Like, I stink too. I have issues too. Like, and we never think about this stuff when we're kids. When we're growing up, it's always like, who's most popular, who's the best, or who's the sportiest, or who's the prettiest, or who's the whatever. And we just automatically distinguish and separate and organize people into their compartments and categories. But then as you get older, you think, man, like, I don't remember actually saying something mean, but I know I withdrew. I know I distinguished, I separated myself in that moment. Here's a question. How do you see others compared to yourself? How do I see others compared to myself? Because I know for me, and maybe I'm the only one, I think of myself higher than everybody else. Right now, man. I think of myself as generally better than everybody else. Maybe that's just me, and that's a fault, and I admit it. But when I come into a conversation, I consider myself the expert. When I have a discussion, I had to find the right word there, with my wife, I know I'm right. Or at least I think I do. Is anybody else like this? Maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm the only one who comes to a relationship or comes to a discussion or comes to a situation thinking that I am better. So how do I see others compared to myself? Do I consider them below me, different than me, separate from me? Because me, I'm me. Let's get back to the text that's safer there. Exodus chapter 8. We'll pick it up, verse 20. Then the Lord said to Moses, get up early in the morning and confront Pharaoh as he goes to the water and say to him, this is what the Lord says, let my people go so that they may worship me. If you do not let my people go, I will send swarms of flies on you and your officials, on your people, and into your houses. The houses of the Egyptians will be full of flies, and even the ground where they are. But on that day, I will deal differently with the land of Goshen, where my people live. No swarms of flies will be there, so that you will know that I, the Lord, am in this land. I will make a distinction between my people and your people. This miraculous sign will occur tomorrow. And the Lord did this. Dense swarms of flies poured into Pharaoh's palace and into the houses of his officials, and throughout the land of Egypt, the land was ruined by the flies. Then Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron and said, go sacrifice to your God here in the land. Moses said, that would not be right. The sacrifices would be detestable to the Egyptians. And if we offer sacrifices that are detestable in their eyes, will they not stone us? We must take a 3-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God as he commands us. Pharaoh said, I'll let you go to offer sacrifices to the Lord your God in the desert, but you must not go very far. Now pray for me. Moses answered, as soon as I leave you, I will pray to the Lord, and tomorrow the flies will leave Pharaoh and his officials and his people. Only be sure that Pharaoh does not act deceitfully again by not letting the people go to offer sacrifices to the Lord. Then Moses left Pharaoh and prayed to the Lord, and the Lord did what Moses asked. The flies left Pharaoh and his officials and his people. Not a fly remained, but this time also Pharaoh hardened his heart and would not let his people go. Now, we mentioned in the past that the Pharaoh and the other Egyptian officials would go down to the river for a ceremonial cleansing. They would worship the river. They considered the Nile itself to be a divine god of sorts. And so they would go down to the river regularly to worship, to bathe in this kind of ceremonial ritual. Now, Pharaoh has just gotten done having all these gnats around for several days, and he makes his way down to the Nile so that he can worship, so that he can do this ceremonial bath and hopefully seek some relief from these gnats. And you can imagine the Pharaoh, he makes his way down, and there's Aaron and Moses. That's got to take you off. Pharaoh's like, what do you want now? Moses says, look, you need to let the people go so that they can worship God. This is his message, not mine. He wants his people to worship him. You got to let them go. Otherwise, here's what's going to happen. He's going to unleash swarms, hordes of flies. And we don't know what kind of flies they were. They could have been house flies. They could have been dog flies. There's also a type of fly called the ichneumon fly, which is really more of a wasp that lays its eggs on things, and then the eggs hatch and they eat them. That's nice. We don't know what kind of fly it was, some airborne insect. And Moses says, these things are going to be unleashed all over. Now here's what's interesting, right? The fly get this is just hilarious. The fly in Egyptian mythology, ancient Egyptian mythology, was considered to be a symbol of fortune, a symbol of protection against misfortune and disease. So if you saw a fly, it meant happy days are ahead. Maybe not. Says there are going to be flies all over the place, in your homes, on the ground, everywhere. Flies. You ever have one fly in your house and it's annoying? You can never find it? You just hear that buzzing, and then when you do spot it, that little booger is so fast, you need Mr. Miyagi to grab it out of the air. It was a David reference. Sorry about that. Flies all over the place. Now, what's interesting is that this is the first plague. I know I'm giving you a lot of facts and fun things like that, but it makes me excited. This is the first plague where God says, okay, I'm going to make a distinction, I'm going to make a difference here. Egypt is going to be invaded with flies. Goshen, where the Israelites are at, will be saved. Up to this point, have you caught that? Up to this point, the Israelites have gone through the plagues as well. But now, God has drawn the line in the sand and controlled the flight patterns of flies. Now, this was before the days of off-repellent, or those little fan things that you wear that creates a nice shield of protection from those pests. But I just picture, like, the Egyptians who live kind of close to Goshen. They're like mowing their yard. Hey, Phil. Hey, Phil. How's it going? Hey, do you have flies in your yard? Nope. It's kind of nice over here. Sunshine. It's a beautiful day. And they're thick over it. My dog is just rolling in flies. I don't know. I think he's alive still. I'm not sure. Hey, how's your food doing? I don't know. Gave him a big fat steak today. It's doing good. They wouldn't have actually done that because they worship cows. But that's a side note. You can imagine the frustration. Imagine the angst and the anger. The Egyptians are suffering. The Israelites are chilling. No flies. No problem. How does that make the Egyptians feel towards the Israelites? Mad, frustrated, angry. How does that make the Israelites feel towards the Egyptians? Something like that. they're finally getting what they deserve. Well, it's about time. So then Pharaoh negotiates like he's still in a position of power. He says, look, you got to take care of these flies. Just take your people and go worship here in town. It'll be fine. Just go do it here. Moses says, we can't do that. We take cows and bulls and we kill them and offer them on the altar as a show of worship. We do that and all of our Egyptian neighbors are going to throw rocks at us. They'll kill us. We can't do that. Let us go a couple days out in the desert, and then it'll be good. Pharaoh says, well, okay, go ahead and go out in the wilderness. Go just go a little bit. Don't go too far. Now pray for me, would you? We try to compromise and still maintain our control. Try and say, well, I'll give you a little bit, but I'm going to stick with what I like, what I need. It's funny, when I was on the road with Dad, we ate a lot of fast food because that's the life of a truck driver. You don't really have time or energy to prepare a salad, so We'd hit a lot of drive-thrus and stop in at a lot of fast food joints. Oftentimes, I'd have to go in and get food for him. And so there'd be times where he'd be like, okay, I want a double quarter pounder with cheese, a large fry, and Diet Coke. And a Frosty. The adding Diet Coke to things makes me laugh. Like, I want 3,000 calories, but we'll get a Diet Coke in there too. Be good. We do that though, right? We do that. We say, God, okay, you want me to. You want me to love my neighbor. I can't really do that, but I tell you what, I'm gonna go to church at least once a month. Or, God, I know you want me to forgive that person who did me wrong, and I really should let that go, but I can't really do that because they are a jerk. And so, what I'm gonna do instead, I tell you what, I'm gonna listen to Christian music on my way to work. It'll be cool. You know what? I know you want me to give, and I really can't because I need 3,000 channels on TV. And so I can't give right now, but I tell you what I can do. I can pray that you'll give me more money. Which we try and negotiate. We say, I can't really go out in the wilderness, but I'm going to stay here in my nice little world where I can control it, where I have control, where I can keep an eye on everything and everyone. We say, God, I know you want me to love and give and forgive wholeheartedly. I just can't. We say, Lord, have mercy on my life, this problem that's going on, this suffering that I'm going through, this struggle that's choking the life out of me, and then in the very next breath say, well, I can't do that, Lord. So then the question becomes, how do I see others? Are they worthy of love, forgiveness, grace? More specifically, are they worthy of my love, my time, my grace? Jeremy Courtney, one of the speakers at Catalyst, you actually heard him a little bit up here on the screen earlier. He had this to say. He said, oftentimes we're trained to see problems, not people. Jeremy works with the Preemptive Love Coalition over in Iraq and Syria, helping folks over there who are in dire straits, their families are torn apart by the war. All too often we see problems and not people, and I would take it a step further that all too often we see people as problems, not people. Did you know that every single person in the world who has ever breathed a breath was once a baby that poops? Every single person on the planet has a mom and a dad. Every single person on the planet has dreams and goals and desires and fears, talents and abilities. But we don't always see that. I mean, from our perspective, we see people as problems. Not worth our time, our energy, our love, our forgiveness. Now, we are worthy of love, forgiveness, grace, time, money, energy, support. But we have a hard time seeing others that way. So how do I see others? Well, let's finish it up here. Exodus chapter 9. Everybody still awake? Most of it. Okay, that's good. Exodus chapter 9. We're going to hit one more plague, then we're done, I promise. Then the Lord said to Moses, go to Pharaoh and say to him, this is what the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, says. Let my people go so that they may worship me. You may have heard that before. If you refuse to let them go and continue to hold them back, the hand of the Lord will bring a terrible plague on your livestock in the field, on your horses and donkeys and camels and cattle and sheep and goats. But the Lord will make a distinction between the livestock of Israel and that of Egypt, so that no animal belonging to the Israelites will die. The Lord set a time and said, tomorrow the Lord will do this in the land. And the next day the Lord did it. All the livestock of the Egyptians died, but not one animal belonging to the Israelites died. Pharaoh sent men to investigate and found that not even one of the animals of the Israelites had died. Yet his heart was unyielding, and he would not let the people go. So all the livestock that's out in the field, one day, the next day, one day, the next day. Can you imagine? You have this huge herd of animals. You go out the next morning, they're all hooves up. It's extensive, too. It's not just cow. He rattles off this whole list of animals. Horses, camels, goats, sheep, cattle, everything out in the field. Dead. But he makes a distinction. The Israelites are saved once again. None of their animals are harmed. They're doing perfectly fine. Hey, Phil. Yeah, what's up? You do something to my dog? No. Okay. All right, what about my cat? Yeah, that was me. Oh. Now, something I should point out. The Lord makes a distinction between Israel and Egypt here and in the previous plague, and it's easy. It would be easy. If I were an Israelite to go, well, it's about time. They got what they deserved. I mean, we are the chosen ones. We are God's people, so we deserve a little relief here. But I want to point out that there is absolutely nothing that the Israelites did that earned them the favor of God. Absolutely nothing. They had no control over what God did or didn't do. It's only by his grace that they were saved. And we'll talk about this a little bit later as well. But the other side of that coin is, well, if they did nothing wrong, did the Egyptians do something wrong? I mean, are they the ones that are going through this judgment, this supposed wrath? Well, let's think about this. How many plagues were there altogether, do you know? Ten plagues. If somebody gave you 10 chances to make the right choice, would they be mean or graceful? If somebody said, I want you to choose yes or no, and you get 10 tries, they're giving you a lot of space, a lot of leeway, a lot of freedom. How do you see it? How do you see it? I mean, ultimately, this whole thing goes back to worship, right? How do you see God? I want to show you a picture. Can you see it back there in the back? Might be a little hard to see. I'll point out some things. This is a bull. Mummy. The mummy of a bull. A mummified bull. They mummified the bull. By the way, this is on display at the Smithsonian. And the little tag underneath says, divine bull. This bull lived like a god in a special stable within the temple walls. Priests massaged the bull's body, decorated his horns with ornaments of silver, and even sang to him. Egyptians saw him as a living manifestation of a god, and worshippers filled the temple daily to honor him. When the bull died, Egyptians believed he went on to eternal life, and a young bull with the same distinctive markings took his place. Many temples honored other sacred animals, for example, crocodiles and cats. And God killed all the bulls. It takes us back to this idea of worship and our perspective and our vision, how we see. Do we see only what we see, or is our perspective broadened? Pharaoh, he heard about this. All the animals outside died. He sent somebody over to Israel, to the Israelite camp there in Goshen, just to see all their animals are healthy, kicking and laughing in the field. And yet, his heart was hardened. He was unyielding. He dug his heels in, too stubborn to admit that he might be wrong. Thank goodness he's the only person in human history who has ever been too stubborn to admit they were wrong. So, the question is, how do I see? From what perspective do I see the world? Some of us, we see things like a captain, as though we are in charge of everything, that we have the grandest view of it all. We see things no one else can see. We know things no one else can know. We are never, ever, ever wrong. Anyone who dares question us, no longer Facebook friends. Some of us
see things from a very low perspective. We are worms. We are pitiful. Please don't look at me. Don't listen to me. Don't do anything. I have no place.
Some of us need to change our perspective. You know what's interesting? Some of us are boiling up over the fact that I'm sitting up here. But perhaps there's no better place. No better place to see our world and the people in it, to see our God, than on top of an altar at the foot of a cross. Laying aside all of our stuff, all of our presuppositions, all the stories that we tell ourselves, all of our opinions and biases about everything. And we humbly listen. Here's the thing about perspective. The only thing that perspective requires is an opinion. But truth requires humility.